If you are an entity whose experiences are constrained by the temporal fourth dimension, time, then you're going to want to watch this. Hey everybody, you're here to improve your life, tactically and philosophically, through books with us. And this week's book is When, The Scientific Secrets of Perfect Timing by Dan Pink. Dan Pink starts us out by presenting us with quite the peculiar question. Did the Lusitania of World War I infamy sink because of a misunderstanding, because of politics, or because it was the afternoon and the captain was tired? Dan Pink says this book is not a how-to, it's a when-to. And in this review, we'll see why getting tired randomly is perfectly normal, how to beat your afternoon slump, and how time shapes the meanings in our lives.
It's gone.
That's gone. So, what are three things we can use from this book? Circadian rhythms, chronobiology, and birds? What a pretty flower. This particular flower blooms when the sun is out. But one day, you shut the blinds because you don't want it to bloom that day. But in the darkness, and as if the sun was shining straight on it, it blooms again. The flower doesn't react to the sunlight. It follows its biological clock, instantiated evolutionarily into its million years ago predecessor's biological functions. I.e., flower opens for sun, even when sun not there. That is a circadian rhythm. Almost all living creatures have a circadian rhythm. Humans, to pick an example at random, have a 24-hour circadian rhythm cycle that affects our mental and physiological processes throughout the day. Generally, you will be alert in the morning, have a slump of energy and brain power in the afternoon, and have a rebound period in the evening. Though, it's a little more wiggly than that. We're all individually on a circadian rhythm spectrum. Some people have their energy in the morning, slump, and then rebound. And some people have more of a recovery chill period, slump, and then boom with energy late into the night. Whichever category you fall into is called your chronotype and is influenced by your chronobiology. The two chronotypes are larks and owls. Early birds are larks, and late birds are owls. But, like I said, it's a spectrum. So, lots of people are arranged at points in between. Third birds, Dan calls them. But the important part of all of this is recognizing this biological circumstance, and then using it to your advantage. But, I've got to explain one more part of this before we can do that. Following along the circadian rhythm of your day, you've got alertness, early for the larks, and late for the owls. And you've got the slump in the middle of the day. You are much more mentally capable in math, logical reasoning, deliberation, and so on in your alert phase. And they've shown that you are much more subject to bias, suggestion, stereotyping, and all sorts of other mental lapses throughout your slump. But weirdly, there's a benefit to the slump. As the analytical mind dozes off, transitioning to the slump, the inhibitions in our mind we command in order to stay vigilant, alert, and focused relax, giving our intuition more free rein and room to play. In a slump, we're more intuitive and are much more subject to what Malcolm Gladwell might call a blink moment of insight. So while the slump is the opposite of the alert phase, it's not all bad. In fact, it presents us with a paradox. The inspiration paradox. The idea that innovation and creativity are greatest when we are not at our best, at least with respect to our circadian rhythms. And here's where we get to the practical part. So everyone has their own chronotype and is located somewhere on the circadian rhythm spectrum. And during that circadian rhythm cycle, you have distinct periods of intellectual capability and bumbling moments of insight and creativity. So, what should you do? Well, you figure out your circadian rhythm and assign particular types of tasks accordingly.
Wow.
If you need to be working on math, logic, problem solving, or on the jury bench, do it in your alert phase. If you need to be more free-minded, creative, and insightful, do it during your slump. You can figure out your chronotype by either taking a test I'll link up in the description, or by observing when you are most awake, in the mornings or at night, and observe when you feel your energy slump. At the least, once you figure out your circadian rhythm, do your best to avoid doing important, intentional work during your slump. Unless, that is, you decide that you're going to defeat your afternoon slump. How to keep that afternoon slump from making you Bernie from Weekend at Bernie's. The gavel strikes, and the course of another life is determined. Too bad it's 1:30 p.m. and not 10 a.m., or this person might have had a more desirable outcome. During the afternoon slump, juries go from fair and balanced to racially biased and suggestible. Nurses and doctors are 4 times more likely to make a mistake while drugging you. Car accidents are at their highest, and judges give fewer chances at parole hearings. The medical cost of the afternoon energy trough, extracted out and multiplied across all the U.S. hospitals, is 600,000 unnecessary infections, $12.5 billion in added costs, and up to 35,000 unnecessary deaths. This is not good. It's bad. But there's a way to shield ourselves from the evil mind control of the slump during our moments of import. To avoid those accidents, car drivers need a break. There are 3 kinds of breaks you can take, and these breaks have been proven to revamp capability and lead the afternoon slump away on a fool's errand, at least for a while. A vigilance break. In one hospital, In one hospital, they take breaks at certain intervals to read out things they've written on bright green cards. They've got the names of the patients they're working on, the drugs they're prescribed, the procedures, the ailments, the family members' names. These card breaks refocus them on the important aspects. They are vigilance breaks. Vigilance breaks massage the mind in the right direction, tagging the important components and aspects to hone in on, giving you a few important factors to work with, helping you and your decreased mental capacity stay focused. Restorative breaks. Restorative breaks are the sighs of relief amid the exhaustive relentlessness of work and upkeep. These breaks give you a, well, break, recharging your executive function for more fulfilling work afterwards. Good restorative breaks are guided by a few different concepts. Move around for good blood flow and energy. Be social for a mood boost. Hug a tree for a nature effect. And fully detach. Don't think about work that you'll be getting back to, so that you can actually recharge. He says, for the full restorative break effect, take a short walk outside with a friend, during which you discuss something other than work. And finally, my favorite kind of break, the siesta. The infamous lazy person's hideaway from responsibility, the productivity ignorer for babies and children, the responsible worker's most condescended activity, a nap. An afternoon nap expands the brain's capacity to learn, boosts short-term memory and associative memory, benefits mood, alertness, and cognitive performance, strengthens the immune system, and even anticipating a nap can reduce blood pressure. No wonder Google has nap pods. Dan says he has figured out the perfect nap, and if you'll let me, I'll describe it for you here. For the perfect nap, sleep for 10 to 20 minutes. 5 minutes doesn't do much, and 30 or more makes you groggy. Set your alarm for 25 minutes, because it generally takes people 7 minutes to fall asleep. Take your nap 7 hours or so after your waking time, because it hits relatively well with the afternoon slump. Take your nap at the same time each day. Habitual nappers get more out of their naps. And drink a cup of coffee right before your nap, because it takes coffee 20 minutes to become active in your bloodstream. When you wake up, you'll be blasted with alertness by what Dan Pink calls the nappuccino. These effects will last for approximately 3 hours, which may be all you need to blast by that afternoon slump's henchman. And with the day-to-day under control, how do we handle time more broadly? Mm. Funky starts, motivational middles, and the flat-out finish. Whether you're running a race, working in a team with a deadline, or making your way through a decade, you'll be contending with a beginning, a middle, and an end. So, let's go through the process, seeing how these intervals affect our psychology, starting with starts. It's the new year. What have we all done? Decided to make some resolutions to our lives. We have a chance for a fresh start, a new us. Not really. We're the same person we were yesterday. There's only 24 hours difference, really. But psychologically, we've ripped the page out and started on a new one. Beginnings switch on our motivation for a fresh start. Dan Pink says we should take advantage of this psychological phenomenon. He says there are 86 different days. You want me to hold you? There are 86 different days in a year that we could potentially use as a fresh start day if we need one. If you falter on your resolutions, hit that fresh start button again on Martin Luther King Jr. Day or Groundhog Day and succeed, propped up by your clean state. Now, middles. You're halfway through the week and realize you've barely started on your paper. You've had all week and you've hardly done anything. But you put your nose to the grindstone and crank it out with a newfound sense of urgency. This is where you look right here. Yeah, in here. A newfound sense of urgency provided to you by your halfway point realization. Dan says that when people realize they are at the midpoint and they're a little behind, it provides them with an uh-oh effect. Recognizing they are short on time, they experience a concentrated midpoint burst. Do this on purpose. Make it an uh-oh, not an oh-no. Imagine that you're behind, but only by a little, and propel yourself toward of your task. And finally, finales. In the maze, they have a path with multiple finish lines. On each finish line is a piece of cheese. They let the rat loose, and they all lean in and stare over top the maze. The rat runs. The closer the rat gets to the cheese, the faster he goes. Where's your milk? Huh? Oh, I see it. Just like humans, he sees the finish line and is extra energized. Dan Pink notes that at the end of each decade of life, we are prone to a re-energized pursuit of significance. Lots of nine-enders, he calls them, though not all decide to run marathons, to finish their 20s, 30s, and 50s strong. So, run through the finish line and end strong. Endings always come. How you feel about a memory is made up of the peak experience combined with the ending experience and results. Endings are usually poignant, bittersweet. It was made up of a lot of good memories. And we learned a lot. But now, it's over.
What is this?
Figure out what bird you are, and you can soar, by assigning your tasks to their optimal times. Give yourself a break, and you'll not only feel better, but do better. And take advantage of the psychological power of starts, middles, and ends to make your dreams real. What a book! Really unique and useful. I generally only write down practical things while I'm taking notes for a book, and I swear during this one my pencil caught fire at one point. I can never include everything from the book in these reviews, and man was there a lot in this book. Much more about circadian rhythms and chronotypes, research on when to get a job, how to get a fast start in your new job, when to get married, when to get a divorce, synchronicity, as similarly described in the book Stealing Fire, how to alter some of our cultural systems with respect to our collective circadian rhythms, and much more. But if you want to get the book yourself, there are plenty of links around I've provided for you. Sorry, I got trigger finger and made the longest review of all time. Maddie, any closing thoughts? If you did like the show, there are two things you can do. You can like it, so more people will be prompted to watch it. Or you can subscribe, so you don't miss next week's video. Thanks for watching with us, and we'll see you next week. Bye.
Bye, Grandpa.